Hi everyone, let's talk about the laryngeal cartilages. The laryngeal cartilages as a complex are referred to as the laryngoskeleton. The laryngoskeleton consists of all of the laryngocartilages of the larynx. To the right here, we can see the anterior view of the neck with the infrahyoid muscles reflected away. Laterally, we can see the contents of the carotid sheath. We can also see anteriorly here the thyroid gland. That would be the right lobe of the gland and the left lobe of the gland. And we can see most prominently here along the midline, that would be one lamina of the thyroid cartilage. That would be the other lamina of the thyroid cartilage. And they would come together here as the laryngeal prominence, AKA the Adam's apple. And the thyroid cartilage is suspended from the hyoid bone, which is located about here, by the thyrohyoid membrane, which I'm drawing in right there. The hyoid bone is approximately at C3, C4 vertebral level. The thyroid cartilage is approximately at C4 vertebral level. The thyroid cartilage sits atop the cricoid cartilage, which I'm drawing in here, which is currently obscured by the cricothyroid muscles. And then between the two, we have the cricothyroid membrane. And this portion is the median cricothyroid membrane. This is the portion which is incised when one performs a cricothyrotomy. Now, looking over here on the left-hand side of the screen, we see a right lateral view of the larynx. So I'll outline the thyroid cartilage here. The thyroid cartilage is incomplete posteriorly, so it is most robust anteriorly. And we could see here is a superior horn, and there is the inferior horn. And that inferior horn of the thyroid cartilage articulates with the cricoid cartilage to form the cricothyroid joint. So this is a pivot joint here. And what happens when the cricothyroid muscle, which has been removed, but which would be located there, contracts, that pulls the thyroid cartilage anteriorly and inferiorly. And what that does is it puts tension on the vocal ligament, or the vocal cords, to increase pitch. Now, when we look at the laryngeal skeleton from a posterior view, we can see a completely different perspective. So just for your own knowledge, the cervical spine has been cut. So there's one side of it, there's the other side of it, and it has been reflected out laterally in a way, so open almost as if it were a book. And we can see the right greater cornua or horn of the hyoid bone there. The left is probably about there, but it's obscured by some tissue. I can see there's the superior horn of the thyroid cartilage, so I'm outlining that thyroid cartilage there. I can see a little bit of it over there as well. Here is the cricoid cartilage, so wrapping around like so and going down. And we can see that the cricoid cartilage is very robust posteriorly. The cricoid cartilage is the only laryngeal cartilage which is complete, 360 degrees about the larynx. So cricoid comes from krikios, which is Greek for ring. Now, sitting atop the cricoid lamina here in the posterior are the arytenoid cartilages. Arytenoid cartilage is our funnel-shaped, and they are obscured here by the posterior arytenoid muscles. So we have the oblique, which are there, and the transverse, which are there. Let me get that out of our way. So these arytenoid cartilages, these sit atop the cricoid cartilage, and they are the most kinetic part of the laryngoskeleton. Most, nearly all, of the intrinsic laryngeal muscles are going to act upon the arytenoid cartilages, either, you know, pivoting them different directions, sliding them together, pulling them apart, because it's these arytenoid cartilages which are going to attach to the vocal ligaments, which then attach to the thyroid cartilage. So this is how we can maintain the patency of the airway, or close off the airway, or affect tension or timbre on the vocal folds. Sitting atop the arytenoid cartilages are the corniculate cartilages, although you're not responsible for seeing these in the laboratory. And then the cuneiform cartilages would rest in the folds lateral to that. Finally, probably one of the more conspicuous things that we can see here in this photograph is the epiglottis, which would be the epiglottic cartilage invested by mucosa. And so this epiglottic cartilage is a single midline unpaired cartilage which can protect the opening to the larynx during times of deglutition or swallowing. So we can see here all of this rugose area, that's the root of the tongue, and as you can imagine, the larynx here is going to sit anterior to the laryngopharynx, and so air is exchanged anteriorly. Posterior to this, the laryngopharynx would be contiguous posteriorly with the esophagus. So this is where the aerodigestive pathway would diverge, and it's, you know, approximately at the level of C6, or the base of the cricoid cartilage, where foodstuffs or liquids are funneled down towards the stomach via the esophagus, whereas air enters in through the laryngeal inlet and heads towards the respiratory system. So we've discussed the various cartilages which comprise the laryngoskeleton, and a little bit of what they've done. Thank you for your time.